I'd like to welcome you to this afternoon's colloquium. My name is Doug Massey. I'm a professor in sociology and Woodrow Wilson School. There was a time in American history when white Americans were not at all shy about expressing their racist viewpoints. If you look at public opinion data from the 1940s and 1950s, substantial majorities of white Americans would come right out and say, black people are inferior, black people should be segregated in schools, black people should go to the back of the bus, we should have laws to prevent blacks and whites from marrying in the states, and that white people should have first crack at good jobs ahead of black Americans. These were forthrightly stated. The 1960s civil rights movement came along. The movement crested in the late 60s and early 70s, and coincident with this, we began to see a shift in white American opinion. And over the next 20 years, outright expressions of racism became increasingly rare. And if you look at public opinion data today, substantial majorities endorse the principle of a racially open society. So very few people say that states should pass laws against intermarriage. Very few people endorse school segregation as a matter of principle. Hardly anyone supports segregation in transportation and accommodation. Those days of open expressions of racism are clearly gone. But that, of course, does not necessarily mean that racism itself has disappeared from American society. And in fact, there's abundant evidence that racial divisions continue to affect us. Levels of segregation in residence and in schools remain extremely high. In fact, school segregation has increased over the past decade or so. Residential segregation has, in some cases, increased, but in most cases has not moved very much. Abundant evidence from audit studies indicates ongoing racial discrimination in housing markets, in labor markets, in sales markets. And so race very clearly has disappeared. And of course, social scientists have noted this and have come up with new ideas about racism and what race is in a post-civil rights environment. And you see this in the proliferation of labels about what the new racism is all about. So some people talk about symbolic racism. Some people talk about laissez-faire racism. Other people will speak of aversive racism. Some people develop scales of modern racism. Our guest today is one of the main participants in this ongoing attempt to understand race in the post-civil rights era. He's best well known for the concept of race-blind racism. And I believe he will be talking about this concept and using it to deconstruct the meaning of race in contemporary American society. Our guest, of course, is Eduardo Bonilla-Silva, professor of sociology at Duke University, and he will be talking about racism, discrimination, and colorblindness in contemporary America. So, Eduardo, thank you for coming.
Thank you. I'm surprised when people clap before they listen to the presenter. You don't want to clap after I finish. So good afternoon. I'm very pleased to be here. However, I present my work with some trepidation for two reasons. First, my theoretical standpoint, analysis, and policy suggestions are not the usual ones aired and debated in public policy circles. Second, I am presenting a talk heavy on theory, and this is always a challenging task. But I have taken a lot of risks in my academic life, and I'm not about to stop doing so today. My goal, hence, is to incite you to consider the merits, if any, of alternative theoretical and public policy paradigms. But if I fail in my provocation, I'll leave tonight, so no harm done to anyone, okay? The title of my talk seems to say it all. It's real. Racism, discrimination, colorblindness, and the future of racial stratification in America. When most whites believe wholeheartedly that racism has declined in significance and that if anything, it is racial minorities who are racializing issues because they, we, play the so-called race card. I argue forcefully in my work that although race, racism, discrimination, and the very nature of racial stratification in the USA have changed, all are still very real and affect the life chances of all of us, not just minorities, but also whites. Let me explain a bit on all these subjects. The first thing I want to address today is conceptual and has, in my view, monumental implications. For most white Americans, talking about racism is talking about the KKK, neo-Nazis, or Archie Bunkers. Thus, they all seem to react almost instinctively, instinctively to events that fit the stereotypical definition of racism, as the irrational beliefs some people have about the presumed racial superiority of some groups compared to others. Accordingly, when Don Imus or Michael Richards, the cosmic character in Seinfeld, say the things they said, or we hear about the current ordeal of the Gina 6 in Louisiana, or about the noose hanging from the tree at the University of Maryland, most whites almost reflexively think that is racist. And what is wrong with interpreting these events as racist? Aren't these things, after all, truly racist? The problem, as I have argued in my work, is twofold. Let me see if I can do this. First, by classifying overt and crass racial events as what racism is all about, we fail to understand that racism forms a social system. I call that in my early work the racialized social system. Charles Mills, a philosopher at Northwestern, and I, among others, have argued that white supremacy has been world systemic since modernity, and perhaps more controversially, that we all participate in this world racial system. If racism were limited to the actions and beliefs of a few silly and obnoxious folks, racism would have been eliminated from the face of the earth a long time ago. But the systems of racial domination we humans created around the admittedly invented category race are still with us because as systems, they are anchored around real practices that produce and reproduce positions of relative privilege for some and of subordination for others. Therefore, the crux of racism as a system is material rather than psychological. White supremacy exists in the world today not as a remnant of slavery and Jim Crow, not as an expression of class anxieties, and not due to some biological adaptation to deal with the other, as some evolutionary psychologists and sociobiologists believe. Instead, white supremacy remains because it benefits those included in what Charles Mills has labeled the racial contract. The second problem with conceiving racism as deviance from social norms, as a psychological quirk, or as overt racial behavior from a few actors in the polity, is that we miss most of the racial affairs happening before our own eyes in contemporary America. As I will argue soon, the bulk of racial events and behaviors in so-called postmodern America are normative, subtle, institutionalized, and apparently non-racial. Thus, by focusing on overt racial events for moral judgment and political action, as we tend to do, think about the case of Gina and how the NAACP, Al Sharpton, Jesse Jackson, and most folks in policy circles reacted. Yeah? So by doing that, we, one, reify and legitimate an erroneous conceptualization of racism, two, cloud efforts to bring to the fore discussions about how race matters in the everyday life, three, help sustain the notion of America the beautiful, as my friend prefers to call it, America the Beautiful, as a country that is no longer racist. Now I wish to talk briefly about the character of discrimination in contemporary America. Once again, I have to make a theoretical intervention so that we can understand each other. The notion of discrimination is fundamentally wedded to the notion of racism as irrational individual level behavior based on prejudice. Schematically speaking, and I think I have it in the board, we claim some individuals are afflicted with the disease of racism, which may lead some of them to develop prejudice, which may lead a small segment to discriminate. The problems I identified about the dominant conception of racism apply also to this notion of discrimination. First, discrimination is examined as individual level actions obviating the larger context of racial activity. So this stand assumes that the polity is not racialized. You may have some people who are infested with disease, but the country is not racialized. Second, individuals who discriminate are regarded as irrational actors suffering from negrophobia and increasingly from Latino-Spanish accent phobia, a perspective that misses the rationality behind racial actions. Third, by focusing on discrimination, we miss normative behavior, which often does not include racial animosity and is still part of the repertoire of everyday racial practices. Accordingly, I urge analysts to bury once and for all the prejudice problematic and replace it with a structural perspective. The term discrimination, I contend, should be replaced with the notion of racial practices, because this term allows us to capture the various mechanisms, actors, groups, and organizations employ or produce to maintain their status in the racial order. I'm going to take my jacket off, so I'm getting happy, happy, happy. I can now proceed to describe the main racial practices responsible for the racial inequality that we observe in contemporary America. I have labeled them in my work as the new racism. The term is not the best, but I was working on this 15 years ago, so one changes, hopefully. By which I mean the subtle, institutional, and apparently beyond race character of most public racial practices. Later on, I'll make a comment about private level behavior. This system of racial practices emerged in the late 1960s and early 70s as one, a result of the civil rights movement, as well as the uncivil rights movement. 250 race riots between 1970 affected how we thought about race. Yeah? Second, as an accommodation to the new geographic location of the, or demographic location of the then largest minority labor groups, so blacks moved from the south, and that forced sort of a rethinking of how we're going to keep racial order in place. Third, as a response of the state to criticisms from socialist and third world countries that pointed out relentlessly in international forums that the USA was preaching democracy abroad when it did not confer that home to minorities. And lastly, as a business necessity, the dominant fraction of capital and its enlightened members had begun discussing the need for changing the racial order since the early 1960s. Let me give you now a few specific examples. We all know how residential segregation was maintained in the Jim Crow era. Racial terrorism by whites, house covenants, neighborhood associations. Those of you who work in the area of social capital should admit that social capital can also be used in a negative way to exclude. Yeah? And the active participation of the federal government, which, among other things, certified racist lending practices, as well as transferred billions of dollars to whites for the construction of roads to access white suburbia. But we also know most of these practices became illegal by the 1960s, and that the normative climate of the late 1960s and 70s made problematic open and clearly racially based exclusionary practices. We all know that there are things that cannot be done publicly unless you want to be sanctioned, meaning lost. However, years after all these changes took place, residential segregation, as Professor Massey and his colleague Nancy Denton have shown clearly in their book American Apartheid, remains extremely high in the country. So how can this be? We know the high level of residential segregation is not because people of color want to self-segregate, as so many whites believe. In fact, researchers such as Raymond Farley, Larry Bobo, and Camille Charles consistently find that people of color express a preference for for living in mixed neighborhoods. Residential segregation remains high because discrimination in the housing and lending markets remains high, period. In a recent report issued by the Civil Rights Project at Harvard titled More Than Money, the authors noted that, quote, affordability alone cannot explain the existing pattern of segregation, and added that the main reasons for continued segregation include stealing by realtors, subprime loans given disproportionately to blacks and Latinos, and a lack of action by the area cities and towns. Another report issued in 2006 by the Fair Housing Center of Greater Boston indicated that their testers experienced discrimination in 45%. So their testers experienced discrimination in 45% of the cases. The report also indicated that besides stealing by realtors, the fundamental tactic to exclude folks of color was providing differential information about the availability of housing units. All in all, they found whites were 5 to 6 times more likely to be told about available units than minority applicants. Let me give you examples of how this happened. The report told of one black tester who was advised that the apartments she had seen were not available until January 1st. The white tester was told December 1st. In another case, the Latino tester and white tester both emailed an agent and left voice messages. The white tester received a return email including photos of an available apartment and made an appointment to see it. The Latino tester received no response from the agent. Regarding the banking industry, the Center for Responsible Lending released a study in 2006 based on 170,000 loans processed in the beautiful state of North Carolina where I reside, and probably includes my loans, so I'm concerned. After controlling for all sorts of factors, they found that, quote, blacks were still 29% more likely to pay a high interest rate on a fixed rate home purchase loan. This hurt me because I'm a black Puerto Rican, so I don't know if I got it on both sides. This means that banks, after years of studies showing their discriminatory practices, after years of lawsuits, still discriminate. In 2006, African Americans were 2.38 times as likely to be denied a conventional mortgage to purchase a home as whites. Is this due to class, as many analysts suggest? I have a book coming out with the title Anything But Racism. It's class, slavery, it's this or that. Well, the same study about discrimination in the market in San Diego noted that, quote, like in the country as a whole, the disparities in rejection rates in San Diego County were, listen, more severe as incomes increased. So it doesn't seem to be due to class. And how many of you saw Paula Zahn's show that aired in February of last year on CNN? In the show, she had a black woman from Detroit named Nanat, who discovered, thanks to an investigation by HUD, that, quote, at the same time she was turned down for a loan by, well, not to name it because they discriminate, it should be named, by Third Bank, people with similar or even weaker financial histories were approved by the bank, and nearly all of them were white. All these housing and banking practices exemplify new style discrimination. Hard to detect and hard to label racial unless one has the smoking gun. And getting the smoking gun of this new discrimination is extremely difficult. You need to have white folks to go around with you to the car dealer, to the apartment, to the streets, to everything. Time does not allow me to go further, but similar practices have been documented in other venues, restaurants, stores, and levels, political level, economic level. So for more on this, you may want to read that book. Chapter 4 of my, hey, you're all happy at Princeton, and I have a son in college, so I need all the love I can get. So read chapter 4 in my book. And I want to give you one example, sort of funny, but real stuff, yeah? So often I go to stores, and because I don't go around with a sign that says special Negro-like person, happens to be a professor at Duke University, So when I go, I'm just a black ontology walking in the store.
Oh,
and invariably, people come and may I help you? No, I'm just looking. 30 seconds later, may I help you? Once I told you 30 seconds ago, I'm just looking. And sometimes they go a third time and come with the may I help you. Black folks in the room already laughing because you know what is behind this transaction. Yeah? So overtly, there is no discrimination. Yeah? They don't call me the N-word or whatever name they want to call me. Black folks, I guess that makes sense. But they're letting me know. So I go now by the rule of two. First time I'm like, no, I'm just, second time I'm like, yeah, you can help. I'm trying to speak this fancy. So far, I'm having for 1,000. Yeah? If discrimination is not the intent, the reaction from the person should be like, And whenever I've done this, they are like, I didn't mean it that way. Of course you did. That's why you're telling me I didn't mean it that way. I travel across the nation, I hear people telling me, right, I'm working a store and they tell us to do it. Or other similar practices such as they go on the public announcement system, the Canadian is in the store.
What words?
Before I move to the next subject, I must state for the record a few important caveats. My argument about the new racism is a macro-level argument, and since racial formations are always locally organized, experienced, and lived, I must confess that there are enormous variations on these practices throughout the country. Although race matters, I used to sort of, in my political life, make the claim that, like Malcolm, the South in the U.S. begins in the border with Canada. And that's sort of an interesting joke, but it's, let's be honest, it's not true. So now I realize that there are variations. Like it's not the same to live in the Pacific Northwest than on the Northeast. It doesn't mean that race doesn't matter here. It matters differently. And me, I prefer to navigate the Northeast and the Pacific Northwest, at least some parts of the Pacific Northwest. Actually, no, Pacific Northwest is really complex. Some parts are really progressive. Some parts are like, you know, also, I must alert that I'm addressing the dominant practice and not all the racial practices that transpire in the country. Finally, and this probably is the most important comment, I acknowledge that I have limited systematic knowledge about the private beliefs and behaviors of whites. Like most of us, I report on public expressed attitudes or behaviors. Therefore, it is possible that with the right methodology, we could examine whites' private views and behaviors and conclude that there are two systems of racial practices coexisting in America today. One public, fitting of what I call the new racism, and one private, which may be closer to the older Jim Crow system of racial practices. So all the work that I know, unsystematic, and therefore we have a concern with reliability, but all the work that I know from people like Joe Fagan, who has a new book, Two-Faced Racism, or the books by people like Ellis Coase, or the book by Louis Otis Graham, member of the club. So all the anecdotal research suggests that there are two Americas, yeah, the public white America, the public one and the private one. Now I want to move on and address the character, nature, and specific components of the dominant racial discourse in the USA. I will be brief on this matter because I assume many in the audience are familiar with my baby book, Racism Without Races, where I examine this subject in depth. In this book, I argue Jim Crow racism has been, for the most part, replaced as the dominant racial discourse of post-civilized America by colorblind racism, no? was ahead. By colorblind racism, I mean a new racial ideology anchored on the abstract and decontextualized use of the principles of liberalism, which furnishes apparently non-racial explanations for all sorts of race-related matters. I suggest, too, doing PowerPoints is strange, yeah? It's a great technology, but then the performance part, because all of you are looking at it like, hey, I'm performing. But But technology is always, you know, a double-edged sword. So I suggest two fundamental things. First, I contend that as the dominant racial discourse in the landscape, most whites subscribe to it wholeheartedly, which means that teaching this stuff is really hard. It's easy for me if I were teaching about Jim Crow, when I'm about those people in Gina, I'm like, oh my, whites in Gina, this is horrible. I'm like, no, my problem is the other 250 million whites who do unbelievable kinds of things. Anyway, this means that when whites tell me, I do not believe or say the things that Don Imus or Michael Richards said, I tell them, so what? This does not mean you are beyond race or racial discourse. And in fact, you may be more of a problem than these folks. As blacks in the South keep telling me all the time, I'm like, I don't like folks in the Midwest or in the North because they hide. At least in the South, it's like, you know, they hate me, they let me know, and I know where I stand. Never understood that until I moved to North Carolina. Second, this colorblind racism ideology, comprised of frames, stylistic components, and racial stories, seems suave, even genteel. But it is not. In fact, it is the most significant political tool to justify the racial status quo in contemporary America. Its elements constitute, I contend, a postmodern Trojan horse that wields the sword from within to defend, glue, and sustain the racial prison we all inhabit. The central frames of this ideology are minimization of racism, cultural racism, naturalization, and abstract liberalism. Abstract liberalism is the central column of this ideology, and it incorporates tenets associated with liberalism, as I said, abstract and decontextualized manner. By framing race-related issues in the language of liberalism, whites can appear reasonable, even moral, while opposing all practical approaches to deal with de facto racial inequality. Let me give you one example. Jim, a 30-year-old computer software salesperson from a privileged background, explained his opposition to affirmative action as follows. Mind you, I'm just examining the frame he invoked to explain his position, and not that saying that if you oppose affirmative action, you are on the wrong side of history, although I support affirmative action 300%. Okay. I think it's unfair top to bottom on everybody and the whole process. It often, you know, discrimination itself is a bad word, right? But you discriminate every day. You want to buy a beer at the store, and there are six kinds of beers you can get, from natural light to some others. And you look at the price, and you look at the kind of beer, and it's a choice that you have. And a lot of that you have laid out in front of you. Which one you get? Now, government sponsors some others and make it cheaper than natural light because it's brewed by someone in Boston. That doesn't make much sense, right? Why would we want that or make some atoms 8 times as expensive because we want people to buy natural light? I always use this quote precisely because it is one that you are like, what is problematic with this? He didn't call me a name. Well, let me tell you what is problematic. Since Jim assumes hiring decisions are like market choices, choosing between competing brands of beer, he embraces a laissez-faire position on hiring. The problem with Jim's view is that labor market discrimination is alive and well. Black and Latino job applicants, as the research from Harvard and other organizations has shown, experience discrimination anywhere between 30 to 50% of the time. And I believe that the data on Latinos is problematic because a lot of the discrimination that we experience is not coded as such, meaning you're on the report. So when it's 30%, I'm sure it's higher. But then 30% is high, yeah? So, and as we know, by research done by some sociologists at Princeton, Deborah Prager, etc. You don't even need to show up to experience discrimination. Yeah? You can just submit an application. Your name is Tyrone. You are not going to get the job. Secondly, so you have that element of discrimination in the labor market still works. And secondly, no matter how much we believe that America is a meritocratic country, which is hard to believe given the president we have, about 80% of jobs are obtained through informal networks, or as I prefer to call it, through the hookup. Not that hookup, the other hookup, okay? So you know someone, and you know, you're here at Princeton, and you are like, what is your last name, Rockefeller? Oh, let's talk, you know. So therefore, by upholding a strong laissez-faire view on hiring, while ignoring the significant impact of discrimination in the labor market and networks, Gene can safely voice his opposition to affirmative action in an apparently race-neutral way. But ideologies are not just about ideas. They are also about style, about verbal strategies to manufacture public racial statements in a period where the normative climate has changed. In the book, I uncover five major stylistic components of colorblindness, namely semantic moves, projection, diminutives, and just a little bit against affirmative action, just a little bit, yeah? Avoidance of racist thought and rhetorical incoherence. For time's sake, I mention only one example of the semantic moves I document in the book. So semantic moves are verbal shields that protect the moral standpoint of those who invoke them, such as, and all of you have heard something like this, I'm not a racist, but, yeah? So you insert this semantic move, and then you can go, why, yeah? I found that I'm not a racist, but in the sample, even though we had some younger folks were more likely to realize this is no longer working well. So they even said, no, that's sort of racist, yeah? So they were less likely to use the I'm not a racist, but, or the some of my best friends are black. But then we're talking about ideologies, and ideologies are always in the making. They're never finished products. So I was not surprised to find other similar moves that we have not analyzed yet, such as the one that I call the yes and no move, where people claim to be on both sides of an issue. But when you read carefully, they really have a strong view in one direction. So the example I have is Sandra, a retail salesperson in her 40s, who answered the question, are you for or against affirmative action in the following apparently cryptic manner. Yes and no. I feel someone should be able to have something, education, job, whatever, because they earn, they deserve, they have the ability to do it. You don't want to put a 6-year-old rocket scientist. They don't have the ability. It doesn't matter if he's black or white. As far as letting one have the job or another one just because of their race or their gender, I don't believe in that. Obviously, Sandra's yes and no stand truly reflects her strong opposition to affirmative action, as she does not find a single reason whatsoever for supporting this program. But again, if she were in a conversation with a mixed company, she could then go back, hey, I told you, I'm ambivalent. And I hate ambivalence. I saw this. The last element I analyze in the book are the various racial stories generated by this ideology. Again, for time's sake, I just mentioned one example of what I label as storylines, by which I mean socially shared tales that are fable-like and incorporate the common schemata and wording. And again, when I mention them, all of you will say, yeah, I heard that one. So the dominant ones in the contemporary period are the past is the past. Have you heard that one? Second one, I didn't own any slave. Third, if Jews, Italians, and the Irish have made it, how come blacks have not? And the last one is, I did not get a job or a promotion or was admitted to Princeton because of a minority. Or Duke, or Harvard, or Yale. Roland, an electrical engineer in his 40s, combined the storylines of the past is the past and the I didn't own any slaves to oppose reparations. Again, I'm not judging whether or not supporting reparations is, or being against reparations is problematic. I'm just analyzing what kind of strategy he used to elaborate his argument. I think they have gotten enough. I don't think we need to pay them anything. But I think as long as they are afforded opportunities, and avail themselves to the opportunities like everybody is. I don't know why we should give them any reparation for something that happened. You know, I can't help what happened in the 1400s, 1500s, or the 1600s, when the blacks were brought over here and put into slavery. I mean, I have no control over that, neither did you. The neither did you is because the interviews, I raised much. So he's talking the white interviewer, so he's like, this is not our problem. Now, the interview was actually... so We were like, whoa, where is it? So I don't think we should do anything as far as reparations are concerned.
The comment on the Palestinian will come in later. So. Of interest here is that although the question dealt with the effects of past and contemporary discrimination, Roland, like most whites, translated the issue to slavery, as if racism were a matter of our remote past. So when we talk about racism, people are like, come on, slavery ended in 18. So we have here now a historical problem, and we need to teach our students that they're missing at least 100 years of history, 1865 to 1965. And let at least this debate whether or not discrimination ended in 65. I think it has not. But at least they must concede, hello, you're forgetting 100 years of discrimination, yeah? Jim Crow wasn't a picnic. Okay, finally, I wish to make a few predictions about the future of racial stratification in our nation. Once again, and I apologize for this, I have to make another short theoretical intervention before making my observations. At the outset of my talk, I suggested the world has been racialized since modernity. I stated that the racial politics that emerged from the 16th century onwards should be called white supremacy orders, as they are all ordained and inspired by the logic of the racial contract. Even countries we label black, such as Haiti, Jamaica, Rwanda, etc., or Asian, Japan, China, etc., are partly structured by this logic. We can talk more about that in the discussion. However, most racial orders, and this is the case, most racial orders in the West system are plural, and I'm using a technical term developed in the recent ethnicity literature by people such as Furnival, Leo Cooper, and not plural in the good sense. It's plural meaning they have 4, 5, 6, 7 different racial categories. Yeah? Therefore, races in most societies in the world, in contrast to races in the Western world, exist as loose categories or spaces with varying degrees of formation or condensation. Yeah? These observations about race in the world are important because I contend that the USA is slowly but surely shedding its traditional biracial, white, non-white, coat and beginning to wear a new racial dress. Specifically, I argue that our racial order is becoming Latin America or Caribbean-like. The emergence of this new order is due to 5 things. First, changes in racial demography of the USA, and yesterday you had a debate about immigration. We know people are mad. Two, the emergence of a kinder and subtler white supremacy, I call it new racism, and its accompanying colorblind racism ideology. Third, the globalization of race relations. So in Western countries that used to be like, oh, racism is the USA, now they have their own racial problems. So you go to France, you go to Germany, etc., etc., etc. Now they are, the whole world has a racial structures. Four, changes in racial statistics. We, for example, have added new categories. And those of us who do any analysis using census data are extremely concerned for good reasons because we are facing the possible elimination of race as an official category, which would make the USA like Brazil or like my country, Puerto Rico. Yeah. Puerto Rico dropped the race category for 40 years. Okay? And guess what happened when it was reintroduced in 2000? You know what is the proportion of white in Puerto Rico? 85%. Several reports are full of measurement errors. We are whiter than the USA. And lastly, the impending end of race-based policies. So if we eliminate affirmative action, we in fact become like most of the world. No better way of denying race. I don't see race, therefore we don't need the race policy. I make 4 basic contentions about the emerging racial order. First, I suggest the new racial order will be apparently fluid and loosely organized around 3 racial groups, namely white, and you have some folks that fit in that category. And it's a heuristic map, not every group is there, but it allows you to get a sense of what I'm talking about. A second group, or space, and I prefer to use a space because I don't think these groups will be jelly the way that the traditional groups did, that I call honorary whites. And a large group at the bottom that I think will be the largest one in the country in the future that I call the collective black, which would include most folks in the New America, such as blacks, dark-skinned Latinos, and some Asian American groups. So already, as a good terrain for debate, you see that theoretically anyone, almost any of the traditional members of traditional groups can fit anywhere. Yeah? So I can have a Latino that can be white, or not white, or collective black. Similar with Asians, etc. Second, I contend that Americans will use in the future, as most people do in the world, all sort of information and criteria to classify individuals racially, such as anyone who is from a different country understands this. It's not just phenotype. Yeah? It is culture, it is language, it is religion, it is education. It is income, and we think about phenotype, it's not just skin. In my native Puerto Rico, although skin tone matters a lot, hair texture, lips, eye color, I kill how I have green eyes, but not black eyes. So in the Puerto Rican meat market, nobody. Second, I contend that America, I already said that, okay. Now, obviously, anyone who is in the area knows that all these elements have been important in American history. Phenotype distinctions have been, social scientists have documented, they are actually even more important than class as factors determining mobility within groups for both blacks and Latinos. So we have worked on that by people like Cedric Herring and Bernanke and Eddie Hayes and Murguia for Latinos. So I'm not making a relatively new claim. What I'm making the claim now is that this thing, which has been with us for a good 100 years, will become even more important, more salient, and may affect the traditional one-drop rule. Who will be regarded as white, black, or any of the other groupings that I suggest will be out there, will no longer be purely determined by admitted ancestry. Third, the documented historical significance of colorism will become systemic, thus providing a real mulatto escape hatch. Those of you who know the work of Carl Dager, yeah? For all people of color. This will allow individuals to achieve racial mobility by using their epidermic or phenotypical capital. Lastly, as our traditional racial groups decline as sites of community, shared experience, and commonality, individual practice of racial mobility will likely replace the collective action strategies of the past. Actors in the subordinate spaces in the order will rely, as most racial subalterns do all over the world, on marrying light-skinned folks, getting educated, cultural assimilation, and learning so-called standard English to move up. So rather than collective strategies, you use level strategies. I have no time to document my predictions about the future of race stratification today, but invite interested parties to read the pertinent chapter in my last commercial. Second edition of my baby book, Racing Without Race. I'm keenly aware that I have said a lot today, that some of what I have said has been theoretical and therefore difficult to understand. And finally, that my ideas run counter to the dominant narratives about race in academia. So now it's time for me to bring my story together and give you some take-home points. Take-home points. First, racism is alive and well, and we in the social sciences ought to work hard at explaining to our audiences that racism forms a structure, or that is institutional, or if you want to use the term, heck, I don't even want to use my own theoretical argument because the language I coined was too convoluted, and I want to be able to communicate with larger audience. Maybe we should use the term developed by my former colleague, Professor Joe Fagan, and call it systemic racism. That may have a more sort of appeal. Second, discrimination, or racial practices, as I call them today, remains in place, but its character and form have changed from overt to covert, from in your face to now you see it, now you don't. And lastly, from organized and state approved to unorganized, flexible, and not formally sanctioned by the state. Third, this new racial structure, which I call the new racism, has shaped a new racial discourse that I label colorblind racism. This new discourse, unlike Jim Crow racism, does not depend on obnoxious and explicitly racialized tropes to defend the racial order. Instead, as I argued, it is anchored on the ideas of liberalism extended to racial matters. As such, it defends the racial order in a formidable yet apparently non-racial manner. It's like that song by Robert Duffler, "Killing Me Softly." Yeah? You kill me softly or you kill me hard, I'm still dead. Yeah? Fourth, the biracial order is changing before our own eyes and morphing into a Latin America-like order. As such, I predict traditional racial groupings and identities will change as a more plural racial order crystallizes. This may have deleterious consequences for racial justice, as a lot of the defense of the racial order will be done by honorary whites. You want to see someone arguing exactly the opposite, as I'm arguing today, read the recent work of Jennifer Hofstra. She believes that this development is salutary because she believes that if we become like Brazil, that's good. As a black Puerto Rican who has lived in many places that have this kind of system, I think it's actually harder to fight when you have these systems that are like, oh, we don't have racism here. My last two observations are policy related. First, the fact-wise regard racism as prejudice and belief it has all but disappeared is neither an accident nor the product of ignorance. Instead, they are collectively forced views that reflect the racial order that benefits whites as a social collectivity. Can we then, given these facts, mobilize whites to appreciate that racism is systemic? My answer follows directly from my theorization. I do not believe there is a rational way of convincing most whites of these two things. Now, we should still try. So in a public debate, I want us to articulate structural, institutional, systemic notion of racism, but I think that there's going to be a resistance by most whites of accepting that. They prefer the comfortable notion that it's prejudice and it is just some southern folks with little education. Yeah? We at Princeton cannot be racist because we're educated. Yeah? Why are you getting so quiet? Cannot mention Princeton? Okay, Duke. We at Duke cannot be racist. Yeah? We're beyond that. That's what we play lacrosse. The morality and epistemology, and now I'm going to get deep because we have been, Tukufo Zubeyri and I have been working on a book that is coming out, so I want to push the ideas out there. The morality and epistemology of the modern world system, premised on the logic of white supremacy, or the white logic, preclude this option because the way whites see things and feel about racial order has been racialized since Enlightenment. Enlightenment forgot to turn the lights on people of color. Read all the Enlightenment heroes, and you'll be like, oh, God, I didn't know that Immanuel Kant didn't believe that black folks were human, you know, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So whites, therefore, have regarded racial others as lesser beings, and in their knowledge, suffering, and struggle as particularistic, subjective, and less important. I wish I could join the social scientific community and postulate that education, conflict resolution, slow change, best practices to deal with race conflicts, cosmopolitanism, human rights, or citizenship will help us get beyond the racial quagmire we face. But the history of the US and the world suggests otherwise. The sad truth is that fundamental changes in racial situations have always been the outcome of social protests, rebellions, and even wars. Our former president of the association, Francis Piven, just finished a book documenting the significance of social protests in the enactment of various policies based on race, class, gender in our history. Thus, my first policy observation is the following. Social protests will be central for achieving social and racial justice in America. Without struggles, our policy suggestions are not likely to be heard and are even less likely to be adopted. My second, it's tough to say that in a public policy school, but I got to speak my mind. And remember, I live tonight, so. My second policy prescription is also directly derived from my theoretical framework and analysis. I contend race-conscious strategies to get over race are better, meaning more efficacious, than all other non-racial alternatives, from the Habermas-inspired racial dialogues that Clinton, for example, attempted to have, apologies for slavery, and I'm not saying you don't get an apology, but I'm saying that will not do much to change position, metropolitanism, as Wilson has argued, or the Wilsonian hidden agenda, class policies, civic engagement, and all the neoliberal, neoconservative suggestions. What America desperately needs are race-based policies to help us get over our historical racial hump. And this sounds odd, but we need clarity about race and racism to get beyond race and racism, period. Cannot just hide it under the rug. Yeah? The social movements I foresee may demand expanded affirmative action programs, reparations, Marshall-like plans for urban America, consistent enforcement of the laws of the land regarding discrimination, as well as new laws to deal with new style discrimination and other things to be determined by social movements. But if America follows the ostrich approach to racial matters, or continues its retreat from the reforms of the 1960s, we may be creating the conditions for deepening our historical racial inequities. And if my predictions about the Latin Americanization of the racial order materialize, we may all shout very proudly and patriotically that we are all Americans, but still have, in Orwellian fashion, some to be more Americans than others. In this brave new world, lesser Americans, however, may one day fulfill Langston Hughes' expectations about the dream deferred. Thank you. Okay, questions, debate, disagreement, hate, love.
To what you said about the globalized international racial system. It's very easy to see for me that there is a globalized system of race inequality, global north versus the global south, etc. It's less evident to me that what you said about America and the advent of new racism applies in the same way to each individual country that you mentioned, China, Japan, African countries, etc. Now, I have studied racism and anti-racism in Russia, where I believe that the problem is actually exactly the other way around. From a system of covert racism, where you were discriminated against because you had a Jewish surname or something like that, but they never told you that that was the reason, to a system now where very obviously people write, I will not rent out my flat to my apartment to someone who's from the Caucasus.
David Duke has been successful.
Extremely successful, yeah. So I was wondering if, and if you look at the work of Michelle Lamont, for example, who was formerly at Princeton, she analyzed the way in which people talk about racism, anti-racism in France and the United States. And judging from her work, what you said about the sort of liberal argument against affirmative action is very much an American problem, because people here really rely on the market. And people in other countries, such as France, are very much more open to an argument based on solidarity. So I was just wondering whether you think what you said about America is really relevant to all other countries in the world.
First clarification, I did not say that the contemporary form of the structure in the US is the one that we have in the world system. What I said was that the world system was racialized and organized and orchestrated by the logic of white supremacy. Therefore, like if we move from race to class, we talk about varieties of capitalism. You can have, like, you know, a brutal capitalism in one place, another place, what Lenin called the democracy as the best possible shell for capitalism. Yeah. So I agree that you can have in one world system of race variations. Yeah. So you can have, and I agree with your analysis that the
Russia switched from sort of covert racism to a more like in-your-face white supremacy tradition. Yeah. So, for example, I mentioned a country that some of you should realize. Haiti? Yeah. Haiti? Haiti is a black country, well, actually, until you go there. And you realize that the logic of white supremacy affected Haiti. And therefore, there the mulattoes play games of, I don't know, Africa. They don't even call black folks blacks, they're African. Yeah? So the mulattoes claim to be French, civilized, etc. In Puerto Rico, we all claim we're all American, we're all Puerto Ricans. Yeah? When we talk to Puerto Ricans, we push a little bit, you're going to get something like, well, we are a mixed country because we are the combination of whites, Españoles, pause, Indians, and then a long pause, Africans. And we got knowledge, traditions, and culture from whites. From Indians, we got bravery. And from blacks, we got music and sabor. So in contrast, Puerto Rico, then you have a different order that is apparently flexible, so it's not the kind that we have in the U.S. Now, the second part of the question is about France, etc., and the Michel Lambert government of liberalism. I went to pains to add that it's not liberalism, it's the use of liberalism in an abstract and decontextualized manner. Yeah? And in that sense, although I'm not an expert on France, I can tell you a bit more. Actually, I did like the paper on France. I'm from Belgium, yeah. I'm not an expert, but some of my best friends are French, yeah. So I did like the paper. And the paper was actually posted when I was working on this book. By chance, I read a book on racial discourse in New Zealand. Guess what? In New Zealand, a lot of the tropes resonate with the way we talk about race in the USA. And I was like, why would New Zealand seem to have ideas and perspectives that are so similar to those of Americans? So when I read about New Zealand, in the process, ended up reading a little bit about France and read about the, what they call differentialist racism. So a lot of the arguments and the ideology of the U.S. fits or is part of the way that people talk about race in this context. Although, when I was writing this piece, I claim the difference is that these countries have this sort of core blindness combined with ethno-nationalism. So we are not racist, we're beyond race, we're all French, but this is a white country. Yeah? Now, move, I wrote that 10 years ago. Think about the contemporary discourse in the US. So we have color blindness, but we are slowly moving maybe to an European pattern where we're beyond race, we're all Americans, but damn immigrants, they are polluting the nation. They are changing the culture. We should do what, you know, kind of policies that they're trying to enforce in European nations, France, Germany, etc. You know, sending people back or at least sort of keeping them segregated. So that would be my answer. We can talk more in the after. I'm not going to go over the dinner. Some of you are going to go over the dinner with me, huh?
There
was another question here.
So I have comment that's also a question, and I'm interested in seeing if you have a comment, which is in having these kinds of debates with our classmates, you notice that oftentimes my white friends will say that certain comments that are made, people don't even realize their own racism, right? So, like walking up to a friend and saying, like assuming that a black person here is on a basketball scholarship or something like that, right? And so that would happen all the time when I go to the gym with a really black woman, people would often ask her that, and I find that such a crazy things ask, but you know, one, when she was at school, there were many black people that were on basketball scholarships, and so they didn't think that was a crazy thing to ask. And anyway, so I guess what
I promise, anyway, this, I wish that it would end us at the level of the university. It goes on.
Right. So when this discussion would come up, their comment would be like, they didn't mean it as a racist comment, they were just, you know, it's an association actually with athletics rather than academics, right? Which is obviously what the problem is there. So my question is, when you have these kinds of comments that happen continuously, and not just in, you know, the white community, but we as people of color often do it against each other, right? So I know the Indian community often builds up out of the same kinds of racism and is liberalized racism that's very prevalent in the white community as well. You mentioned that you thought of the laws and it sort of counter the new racism. And so I guess my question is, what kind of laws would you propose? Like, what are ways that we can counter it? And two, what are ways that we can actually make people white and people of color aware of these kinds of things? In a way that's open, we don't become defensive, and it's a big, difficult discussion because it's so peripheral.
Now, the end of the thought, I'm a sort of presumptivist. And as I think at the end of the day, I don't believe it's going to be a national discussion, but I'm not too convinced by white masses. Assuming I'm right, and the system is based on the material foundation of people and not to be the able who are get advantage of the people and knowing socialism, I don't want to be at all, I want to be in the history of social mobilizations by groups who are at the bottom of anyone, whether it is based on class, gender, or any other category distinction, suggests that people have to fight, missing the fight that they need to articulate ones. So I suggest that you develop a social movement, let's call it a sort of neo civil rights movement,
mm-hmm.
or social justice. It will be different. In the conclusion of that book, I then articulate that it cannot be a recreation of the old civil rights movement. That movement doesn't fit the contemporary people. The landscape of race has changed. So a new civil rights movement, we have to contend with Latino. We cannot just continue with that, hey, blacks, we know. And it cannot be based also on the sexist paradigm of that movement.
Mm.
It has to be gender sensitive. It also has to be class sensitive. Yeah. So it cannot just argue and articulate the viewpoint of the needs of the black man. It has to say, you know what? Lots of people happen to be in this, I don't want to use the term for, let's call it the underclass, poor blacks, poor Latinos, and having access to Princeton won't do much for those folks. Yeah. So therefore, the new movement will have to articulate an agenda that is class sensitive, obviously race sensitive, gender sensitive. The policies, I articulated a few there. So we can do a Marshall Plan. Yeah. If we were able to rebuild Europe, why the hell we cannot rebuild our own country? Why do we have New Orleans? Because people were like, my God, look at New Orleans. My God, go to Chicago, go to New York. This is not just New Orleans. Concentrated poverty in minority areas is across the nation. But because of segregation and the fact that we have these sort of white communities that don't see pause until the 10 o'clock news, and they see us as criminals, then the empathy for us is that natural. So many policies can be articulated and we can discuss more tonight, but fundamentally, the policy won't go anywhere unless we develop a progressive movement. And actually, the old Rascal March, we have it all. Yeah? But not because of his argument with 150. Workers of the world unite. Guess what? Check the data on the new working class. Increasingly minority. Increasingly female. So therefore, the new working class movement will have to be sensitive to the race and gender. So that would be the beginning of this. One, two, three, four.
My question had to do with the difference between covert and overt expressions of racism. And sort of deals with when members of a particular racial group engage in behavior that disproportionately is shown to happen in that particular group. So I'm thinking about blacks who commit crimes or Latinos who immigrate to regions that are considered illegal. And so that sort of grants an opportunity for the expression of more overt forms of racism that is coded in the sense that, well, they deserve such and such to happen to them, not because of their racial group, but because of what they've done in addition to it. I don't know if you could sort of talk about how that sort of interacts with the covert expression of racism that you mentioned.
I think you're onto something. To be honest, I haven't thought systematically about that. I do, and that's why I wanted to add this important caveat about private behaviors that may not be even read or understood properly. We don't have systematic data. on racial profiling, just in terms of the political, everyone. You know? We do that on a regular day, so all of us can say, yeah, happened to me in this part. Yeah, it happened to me. And it wasn't covert, it was like, hey, what are you doing? You know? But on that, we don't have a systematic data. But your intuition about how that becomes sort of invisible to everybody and therefore sort of covert and hidden is interesting. Yeah, so it can be sort of eliminated from public discussions because it's like, well, this is the service punishment for this kind of actions. Actually, I'm not working on a project. I'm going to emancipate myself from mental slavery following the book mark. I want to write a book, straightforward, titled The Invisible Way of Race, addressing the many ways, invisible ways, in which race matters in the everyday. So, I see I'm tired of going and buying a Band-Aid, flesh tone. And like, what do you mean flesh tone? You mean what flesh tone? Yeah? Well, you go to the movies. I have a very good friend, I don't for him. And for 15 years, I've been telling him, I will go to movies because it's a white movie. And I'm like, hey, you have to read that. And I realize he's lying. What happens when we go to all these movies? Our movies are immediately, well, it's a bad movie. The other movies are just movies. But in truth, they're asking us to suspend belief and have, like, relate to the universal. Of course, the universal is never us, yeah? The universal is always white. And we're asked to suspend belief and be like, you know, crying for, like, you know, for Bambi, whatever. So I thank you for that comment because I think that Mary can still, I mean, incorporate what I say in my new work.
Well, it seemed the thesis of your talk was that power is organized in the world now on racial terms. But that brings up the possibility that there's other ways of organizing power. And even your suggestion about a Marshall Plan for our cities, that isn't actually a race-conscious social policy. That's framed in sort of neutral terms, helping poor people. So it seems to me that those types of policies have better possibilities to deconstruct a political system that's based on race and base that system on other forms of power. And I guess my premise is there's always going to be forms of power behind any political system. So to me, we should move towards a non-racial political system.
That may be the ultimate goal. The issue for us will be how to get there. No, but one clarification, I never said that power in the world system is organized only along racial lines.
No.
But then the second issue is that, for example, the Marshall Plan, on this we may agree that we disagree. But I think that as soon as we propose a policy for urban America, you know how people read urban, yeah? It's a code word for what? Black and increasingly Latino. So if we say we want to have a Marshall Plan to revitalize urban communities across the nation, you know what is going to be the reaction? That's for black people. Why should we waste our time on people that, you know, need what they need to do is get a job and stop committing crime and be good citizens, etc. So I do agree that the language seems to be race neutral. But again, in this new America, a lot of the terms that were seemingly race neutral have become racialized. If I talk about welfare, and you know the statistics, I can tell you, look, although blacks and Latinos may be overrepresented proportional to the population, if you look at the people who receive welfare, I'm talking the welfare that we talk about, we don't talk about the welfare to corporate America, that receives 10 times more than poor folks. So let's talk about the welfare for poor folks. In absolute terms, whites get more welfare than people of color. But in the debate out there, if I talk about, let's have a welfare system that is mean, humane. I mean, think about President Bush vetoing this policy yesterday or whatever it was, helping a few children. I'm like, oh, these people, this is going to be a socialist deal. I'm like, because, you know, they want to give money. They want to help families that make $50,000. Well, you know what? America has changed. And if you have a kid with a serious disease, I can guarantee you $50,000 is nothing. If you give this medical attention and you don't have the support from the state, the welfare state,
you are in trouble. However, whenever you talk about welfare, you know the data probably as better as I do, that as soon as you talk welfare, people queue and read as one. Race is double. That would be my answer. That although I do agree with your ultimate goal of getting to equality, where race as division, I like race as ethnicity. I want to keep my Puerto Rican soul forever. But I want to live in a society that is multicultural and where race is no longer a category of oppression. Yeah? But how to get there? And I suggest that in an apparently contradictory way, the best way of getting there to the promised land is by recognizing that race matters, that race is real, as the title of my talk today suggested, and therefore we need to deal with the reality in order to get to the promised land. But we can talk more later. And then there was another question. Yeah.
I want to sort of push your pessimism a little bit further, because part of your conclusion was, in order to get to the promised land, there will need to be social protest, social movement that would get us the social policy that was race conscious. Yet earlier in your discussion, you made particular note of the fact that, and this is at this point a hypothesis because theoretical, that individual action and individual racial mobility is increasing versus collective action. So in light of those two things, how do we actually get to social protests and social movements when people are becoming more individualistic and less collective?
My answer to that is forecast. I'm forecasting something that is in the process of the past. So I don't believe we already have this Latin American icon. I did do some analysis that suggests that the trends are in place. I don't think we have it there now. A few decades to materialize. But every new order creates also possibilities. What is the possibility in this order? Think about it. If I am black, the people at the bottom of the order, that I call the collective black, will be the numeric majority. So that allows us to still create, to politicize, and to tell folks, look, we are not only the majority, and we can use our power, our demographic numeric power, to fight back, to create social movement, to create demands, to vote if need be, or to vote in the streets, yeah? Now, going back to the pessimistic, to the pessimist side of my pessimism, hard, yeah, because the data from the West suggests that when these orders emerge, the collective elements of racial formation decline, and it's the individual levels that increase in significance. And therefore, harder for you to mobilize when people can basically free ride, yeah? They can become free riders and say, why should I waste my time mobilizing with other folks when I can just individually marry light skin, go to Princeton, do that, and free ride, and then change the category and call myself Cabernation. Yeah? And if that sticks, I'm Cabernation, I'm not black. So it depends on what kind of political engagement we do. The interesting thing is that many of the Latin American orders, maybe going back to your first question, are going sort of in the opposite direction. So after years of playing the sort of we're racial democracy, we are not profit. Now Brazil is developing what they call positive action, which is affirmative action. Even in Cuba, they're having some discussions. Not the most efficient discussions, I believe, but something is better than nothing. And in my own native Puerto Rico, I got the best sociology education anyone can get. they didn't have a course on race. I mean, race blindness was so strong that they did not believe necessary to teach a course on race. I have the distinct honor to graduate the graduate program with my own alma mater 3 years ago. And guess what? Now they have. So,
just in response to this gentleman's question, it sounded like you were saying we have to take a step backward to move forward, in that to create political power, people have to segregate themselves into a cultural group to arm themselves politically. There is power in numbers, so all Mexican Americans should gather together and segregate themselves to forward their political cause of, say, the immigration issue or anything like that. Is that what you're saying? That we have.
I wouldn't use the term segregate themselves. Segregation is what Marx is talking about. It's a process. Someone segregates you. Usually, the data shows that you're on self-segregation. You're forced into corners, whether it's neighborhoods, bad jobs, etc. But after you have that, then you create, again, every structure of domination produces the weapons to eliminate. So you segregate, you put in corners, so that creates also the possibility for people saying, you know what, you and I are in the same boat. And who is giving us help? We use the language of the six. The man is giving us help. So let's fight back. And I was pleasantly surprised, and to be honest, we in sociology and we in academia in general didn't do a good job at predicting the massive mobilizations in immigration matters. I mean, I don't know if you guys were surprised. I was surprised. Because seemingly, one would say, most of these folks are undocumented. These are the most vulnerable actors in contemporary America, at least as you can see. Yet, massive mobilization. So again, even in the midst of this sort of fascistic view of America, folks are fighting back. So I'm surprised, and maybe on that, the opt-in side prevails over the pessimistic side.
Well, if there's no more questions, I'll conclude with my own observation. One of the most intriguing and I think important things that I take from your talk today and from all of your writings is the power of the appropriation of classical liberal ideology in the pursuit of really what is a racial project. And of course, this is an old story in America. We enacted a constitution in 1789 that provided for chattel slavery of African people of African origin without ever mentioning black, without ever mentioning slave, without ever mentioning race anywhere in the Constitution. It was all dressed up in the language of classical liberalism. And then, of course, when that fell apart after the Civil War and Reconstruction, then it was reinstituted and given the imprimatur of the Supreme Court under the Plessy decision, separate but equally. When separate but equal was overturned in the Civil Rights Movement, that's when you find the rise of this the Federalist Movement, the Federalist Society. And I think you're seeing the culmination of this latest movement right now. Four of the nine Supreme Court justices basically are products of the Federalist Society. They're obviously engaged in a racial project. They use the language of classical liberalism to say that the state can't intervene along racial lines, assuming, of course, that the markets and everything are operating in a race-neutral manner, when in fact abundant evidence shows that is not the case, and they willfully ignore that. And I invite people to read the last issue of the New York Review of Books, where Rob Werben disentangles and deconstructs the latest Supreme Court decisions on school desegregation to show precisely what you're talking about.
And on Sunday, we had the CBS 60 Minutes, the info version for Clarence. I don't know how many of you saw. 60 Minutes. So you know that Clarence Thomas has his memoirs coming out. 60 Minutes did 30 minutes. I mean, this is just ridiculous on his life. And now this sort of, again, in this sort of new racist era, he has incorporated, sanitized for the black and minority, the racial and minorities, who us in. So you have Clarence Thomas doing sort of a reconstructing narrative of his life and claiming he was a radical. People misunderstood him. Talking about that, my grandfather's son, and as those of you who watch the show, talking about Anita Hill. And that explains those of you who read the New York Times. So yesterday, Anita Hill went, hey, look, the data is in, man. So, what is your data that you didn't know? What is your data? Okay, I have maybe time for one more question. Mark, we go to David. Yes.
I just wanted to ask you more about the notion of irrationality and rationality in racism. And I also want to say I agree 100% with the main themes of your talk. But on that issue of whether or not it's rational for whites to be racist, I want you to sort of get it out of the way.
By rational, I don't mean that it's something... rational means that there is a motivation behind racial behavior. It doesn't mean, I'm not taking a moralistic stance. I'm not saying, by rational, I mean it's good.
Right. You mean they benefit economically?
They benefit. So the rationality, because the alternative is folks are stupid. And they're dumb. Think about the traditional Marxist tradition of racism. Racism is an ideology that is out there, which is used by the bourgeoisie to divide workers. So therefore, one has to believe that workers are not really benefiting in any way from things. And secondly, that capitalists are hyper-rational actors who know that race is nonsense. And they're using this in an instrumental way to advance their class interests. So therefore, they're not really racialized actors. Yeah? They're just instrumental actors trying to maximize profits. But the world system, when it was created in the 15th, 16th century, following the arguments of Immanuel Wallerstein, was a class, race, order, yeah? And gender. So those capitalists were also based white, were gender. So their agendas, their program, their viewpoints reflected who they were. They were not just sort of laissez faire. They were also into the view, let's kill some Indian. Let's leave off African people. So the same people who developed, think about Immanuel Kant, I mentioned before. So-called father of modern, moral philosophy, and not one of excluding most of the people in the world from the moral stuff. We're like out of the paradigm. So therefore, my argument is that the rationality is I follow this order. And I don't think it's that people sit with a calculator machine and are like,
sure,
okay, by doing this, I'm getting like a 20% higher likelihood of getting a good job, or, that's not the way that we humans behave. It's just that the entire system is orchestrated around practices that are beneficial. And people unconsciously, some consciously, and most just following the script of life.
Yeah.
If you live in a white society, in a white community, and you have exclusively white friends, well, that becomes normal. Yeah? So it is beyond good and evil. After the systems are structured, you sort of follow the script, and that's it. A few actors are more sort of motivated, but most people just say, hey, I just grew up in a normal community. In my book, I document that the extreme segregation, hyper-segregation, according to Professor Massey, that whites experience. But guess what? When you ask them, so how do you feel about living in a totally white neighborhood? She was saying today, whites, whites, whites. It's funny because we usually don't call folks white. So I am always a minority professor. But my colleagues are just professors. And when I go and tell them, this committee is not a fair committee because you're going to evaluate the work of this black friend, at least 12 whites. And they're like, what do you mean? And I tell them, if the committee was 12 black folks and you have a white candidate, you can bet that all of you would be like, this is unfair. This is going to be some kind of reverse racism, blah, 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 blah. But that's the power of government, of being the sort of norm, and then your identity and your position sort of dissipates. And it is the others who are placed. I am raised, but for now.
What I would want to say to that and hear what your response would be is that from my point of view, to be racist, whether it's in markets, if you're lending or if you're a proprietor, then it's as if you have to impose a cost. If you're saying, I'm not going to do business with these people, that's sort of lost revenue. So it's almost as if that I would see that as economically irrational.
Berger made an argument 50 years ago. He was a Nobel economist. I don't think the data bears that out. You can discriminate and make profits. I mean, you can create South Africa. Yeah?
Yeah. We can create the system and say, you know what, we're going to be a capitalist society. I mean, South Africa under apartheid was a it was a super capitalist society that worked under the most sort of a oppressive, repressive race regime. So race regimes, whether they're overt or covert, can coexist with sort of profit-based capitalist values.
No, I agree with that point. The last thing is just that I would say that there's externalities to racism that aren't included in the price. So like so great social costs from keeping people from
grabbing first. On your side, did the book by Bill Fagan and Hernan Vera,
okay,
White Racism, they talk about racism as a societal race.
Do you agree with that? Or?
No.
Okay.
But I want to give you the other side. I'm not the only person out there. There's lots of people talking about this. I think he's wrong because they're talking about if. And I'm a person who is always about what is. So I know that theoretically, we probably would be better off collectively if we eliminate this racial nonsense. But my analysis has to be of what is, so we can get to the what could be. Okay, so
on that note, I'd like to thank you. Thank you.